Okay, our next speaker is Phil Dickerson, who works for the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, and he's going to be talking about how they have been using Google Earth to visualize real-time air quality data.
Thanks, John. As John said, I'm Phil Dickerson with the Environmental Protection Agency, Office of Air Quality Planning and Standards, located in Research Triangle Park, North Carolina. And I'm going to be telling you a little bit about what we're doing with virtual globes and real-time air quality data. So first of all, a little bit of background about air quality. Obviously, air pollution affects everyone. Unlike some of the other environments that EPA is concerned with, everybody has to breathe the air. Poor air quality can aggravate lung disease, including asthma, heart disease, including congestive heart failure. And those kind of effects result in more premature deaths, more admissions to hospitals, more trips to the emergency room, more visits to doctor's offices, more school and work absences for folks that are affected by those symptoms, and more days with symptoms. So basically, very quickly, what EPA does in the realm of air quality data. The Clean Air Act actually requires monitoring and reporting of air quality data. A bevy of state and local agencies collect that data and report it to EPA. There's not an actual regulatory requirement for real-time reporting, which will come into play when I talk about the Air Now program. EPA manages the Air Quality System, AQS, which is actually the largest database of air quality measurements in the world. It goes back to as early as the 1950s. That AQS data, as I mentioned, is supplied by those state, local, tribal, and federal agencies, and it's used to determine compliance with the National Ambient Air Quality Standards. So if you've ever heard the phrases non-attainment area, that's what we're judging based on this AQS data. The reason I point that out is because the Air Now program actually provides real-time air quality data and forecasts for the public. So about 10 years ago, EPA found that our Region 1 office in the Northeast was gathering up real-time air quality data three times each day and creating maps for the public. So in 1997, we got some funding to try to expand that effort nationwide. I bring this up in contrast to the air quality system, which we use for our regulatory purposes. This is actually reported in real time, which again is not required by regulation. And we have mostly a focus upon the public. This also leverages existing monitoring activities. The state and locals are getting EPA grants to do this monitoring, and we're just building upon that monitoring network that already exists. We have a very diverse stakeholder community. We have federal, state, provincial, tribal, and local air agencies, and there are over 120 of those agencies that are submitting their data voluntarily to the Air Now program. We also have scientific and health research organizations that are actually using that real-time data to study health effects on humans. We also have a lot of media and public outreach groups. Our data actually goes to CNN, USA Today, the Weather Channel, media outlets like that. We do a lot of education and outreach through the Air Now program. Ozone in particular was difficult to visualize since it's an odorless, colorless gas, and we actually gave the public a tool that they could kind of see how ozone formed in the atmosphere and watch it move about. We also have international interest in activities. We're actually piloting a version of the Air Now system in Shanghai, China right now. The Chinese saw the success the U.S. had with Air Now, and they wanted to duplicate the system, so we're actually designing an entirely new system that we'll use in Shanghai and in the U.S. next year. This bottom flow diagram is a very brief description of how the AirNow system actually works. We have those 120-plus state and local air agencies. They submit their data to the AirNow Data Management Center, which is actually not far from here up in Petaluma, California. They submit observations every hour, 24/7, and they also submit forecasts to this Data Management Center. We take that and then turn around and create a national data set and a national set of maps and forecasts. We then form the function of distributing that data and forecast to the media and also to the public via our airnow.gov website. And we hope that that information gets into the hands of decision makers and the public so that they can avoid exposure to unhealthy levels of air quality. On the right-hand side, you'll see in 1997, this represents that first regional effort. EPA took that over, and the 2007 view shows that we've expanded it to all 50 states and even the provinces of Canada. The bottom graphic shows a special purpose map that we drew for the Alaska fires a couple of years ago. Anytime there's an emergency or a special event, we'll contribute by creating real-time data products for that particular event. So a little bit more about AIRNOW. As you've probably figured out by now, we do a lot of coordination between the state and local agencies and the media. We provide centralization for all this air quality data that's collected at various levels across the country. We convert all the raw data to the Air Quality Index, which is our public tool for reporting air quality. It's a five-color system that also contains health effects information so that the public can actually figure out what the air quality is and what they can do about it. And we do a lot of education and lots of distribution. Over on the right-hand side, you see some of the many ways we distribute this air quality data. That first one there is actually what I'm going to show in a minute, which is one of our KML products. And then we have contour maps of ozone, which you see right beside the Google Earth window there. We also get our data onto CNN. We have a system that allows you to subscribe to get real-time air quality alerts on your cell phone or pager. And we also get coverage on the Weather Channel, USA Today, and various other media outlets. A little bit more about some of the products we do in the AIRNOW system. As I've mentioned, we have real-time hourly data. We have forecasts coming in for over 300 cities. We produce a national outlook, which is kind of like the weather map you see on TV at night that predicts where air quality problems will occur in the next day or two. We do news stories for particular wide regional events or in special cases like wildfires. We have webcams so that people can visually get an idea of what the air quality looks like. And we do yearly air comparisons to show how this year compares to last year or the last 5 years. So what we're doing with KML, we actually have a dynamically created KML file or several files that we create. We've got the most current air quality index and we update that every hour as the new data comes in. We have today's and tomorrow's forecast air quality index, and those are all updated on an hourly basis based on the latest data that comes in. The KMLs also give more information via pop-up boxes. They give you the ozone and particulate matter AQI concentrations for a location and give you links to more information in case you have other questions. Outside of my program, EPA is also doing some other air quality applications. We have a KML file for emissions data. It has a really neat feature where basically the height of the balloon shows the total emissions for a facility, and I'll show that in just a moment. We also allow people to see where the actual air quality monitors are located via a KML. And that's a very neat function because in the past, people might find the address of a monitor. They might be able to plot it on a map, but with Google Earth, you can now actually see what's around that monitor and detect if there are schools or parking lots or if it's near a busy intersection, things like that. So I've come to the part where I'm going to try to do some live demonstrations, which is kind of the technology equivalent of a bungee jump, but we'll hope it works. First, the location of air quality monitors. This takes you to an EPA webpage, and we monitor for a variety of different pollutants, so you can pull up these different layers depending on the pollutant you're interested in. I'm going to click on the ozone layer. Oh, that was an interesting choice, the ozone layer. This is actually ground-based ozone, so don't get that confused. So what we're doing here is we're pulling up a live KML file of the actual ozone monitoring locations. And you can zoom in on this. Having a little trouble with my mouse. Here we go. If you zoom in here, whoops, okay. You can actually see the monitoring locations. And if you click on one, you can get more information about that particular monitor. So you'll see here this particular monitor I chose is in Salt Lake, near Salt Lake City in Utah. You can get a lot of different information about the monitor itself that comes out of our air quality system, and you can even download some of the historical data for that particular site. Obviously, you can zoom in closer and see what kind of terrain the monitor has around it and get a lot of different visual information. I'm going to jump back out. Whoops. Didn't mean to do that. Okay. This next one is actually a KML file that references three other KML files, which give you information on current air quality and forecasts. Okay. So again, we're loading Google Earth here. We're grabbing three files that are generated every hour by the AirNow system. One has the latest conditions at every major metropolitan area. The other has a forecast for today and a forecast for tomorrow. And I'm just going to zoom in on one here. So we'll see there's one in the Denver area. When you mouse over it, you see the current AQI is 94, which is a yellow AQI. If you click on it, you get a pop-up box. And you'll see here immediately the PM 2.5 AQI is 94, the ozone AQI is 32. EPA regulations require that the cities report whichever is highest, so that's where the 94 is coming from. Okay. And then over on the side, you'll see the radio buttons. You can switch to today's forecast as another view. And it will take it a minute to load. And these, you can see the forecast for Denver for today is that it will reach a 50. And if you click on that again, you'll see that the 50, it looks like ozone and PM are going to be 50. Interesting. So that's the forecast for today. Similarly, if you click on the next radio button, you can get tomorrow's forecast. And you see it's 50 for tomorrow as well. One thing I forgot to point out, just so you know, there's no tricks up my sleeve. If you'll notice here, this data was at 3 o'clock Mountain Standard Time. So it is almost real time there. And lastly, another group in my office does national emissions inventory, which is a collection of all the facility emissions data. They've also done a KML file with that data. And on this one, when you bring this up, it'll show you the locations of actual plants across the country, and that's why there's so many of those little balloons. And if you zoom into one, you'll see the balloon gives you more information on that facility. It also gives you a graph of the different emissions coming out of that facility and their relative contribution to the total. And my favorite feature of this particular map is if you rotate the map like so, the height of the balloon actually is the total emissions of those sources. So when you look across the landscape, you can see the highest balloons are the facilities that are emitting the highest amount for that particular area. So if we click on one of those, you'll see its emissions are fairly high compared to some of its neighbors. Okay. And that is about all I have. I'll encourage you to visit our website, airnow.gov. where you can find a lot more information on air quality, including information about the air quality index. You can get data, forecasts, news items, publications, and a lot more. And at this point, I'll take questions. Yes. Ah. Yes, the question was, how do we do forecasts and how good are they? The forecasts are actually done, again, by the state and local agencies, and they use a variety of different methods. Some of them are statistical, some of them are numeric models, and every now and then they actually use some human intuition, which you could also call a guess. And so the different methods have different degrees of accuracy, and it also depends a lot on the weather, because air quality is very much affected by the meteorology. So as far as accuracy, kind of a rule of thumb is it's somewhere in the range of 70 to 75% on average, but it varies a lot depending on the area and the technique. Another thing I should add is our friends at NOAA have a national air quality forecast model for ozone right now. So if you go to NOAA's website, you can actually see their numerical model of the entire country for ozone, and they're doing an experimental domain for particulate matter. So there's a lot of different products out there that figure into the forecasts. Okay, any other questions? Thank you.